Thank you, everyone, and welcome, to all of you from Chambers to, attend this webinar. Both Mohan and I are extremely happy, to be addressing all of you today. And we would really like to thank, two of our colleagues, Shabnam Sheikh, as well as Anvita Mishra, who have both assisted us in making this presentation. So while we go into this presentation, we would first, take you through the entire framework in the sense of the emergence of family offices. In our presentation, we will be discussing about the introduction to family offices, the legal and commercial concerns, case studies in the sense of, family offices in existence in India, the CIC and the NBFC considerations, SEBI as well as FEMA, and what does the future hold with respect to family offices? Yeah, Mohan, if you could change it here.
What we will also be picking up is once we've considered different structures, we will also discuss what are the implications for co-invest companies, non-banking financial companies, and what are the specific concerns under the foreign exchange and the securities laws so far as these succession structures are concerned.
Okay. So let us, first step back before we really go into, whether there is a definition of a family office or not. Let us really, think as to why has there been an emergence of family offices, not only in India, but also globally, right? Now, the family office is thriving across the globe and nowhere more so than in the Asia-Pac region, where private wealth is expanding at such a remarkable pace. So there are a number of, drivers behind this institutionalization as well as professionalization of the management of private wealth of Asia's high net worth individuals as well as the ultra wealthy families. These include the immense proliferation of global regulations as well as the associated tax revenue, maximization and information sharing and cooperation between national governments and their authorities. And of course, the tighter supervision of the financial advisory community and their clients. So friends, all of y'all would be aware of the, infamous or famous Panama as well as Paradise Papers, revelations. And you would note that in most situations, these are structures which are really capturing the family wealth, albeit, perhaps in a jurisdiction outside of India, as well as in, structures which may be considered as slightly opaque and not as regulated. Now, with this entire media disclosures with respect to Panama as well as Paradise Papers, it has put the entire family office space in an entire ultra HNW and wealth management community on notice to work in a much more regulated, well-reputed, as well as in jurisdictions which are extremely well-regarded. There is also very well documented documentation, with respect to aging founders, of Asia's business dynasties and even of the second generation of Asia's uber wealthy, making the formalization of legacy planning and intergenerational wealth transfer even more critical. Now, when we really look at this entire emergence of private wealth in India, more so, we are looking at, trusts really coming into the picture. We are looking at, wills being written, wherein we never really had, wills being in the foreplay, especially given the fact that many Indians believe that if they really thought of death, they will actually have to face it much earlier than later. And which is where, a lot of families have now, because of their truly global nature, as well as the widespread, reach of assets, have now come to a much more documented as well as regimented succession planning, be it by way of a family constitution, be it by way of trusts, wills, family arrangements, dispute mechanisms, etc. Now, what we've seen in the emergence of any of this is the creation of family offices. Why are they really created? You've seen a lot of situations wherein you've seen promoters of extremely successful businesses having had a long run, creating that particular business, have situations where their family members are just not interested in running that particular family business. and they may actually be more interested in newer business forms like e-commerce or online marketing, etc. We've seen situations where a lot of promoters have now become much more mature, where they recognize that they do need to live up with their children's aspirations and allow them to have free wings, wherein they really get the wealth, but at the end of it, they are not really forced to actually manage, you know, a family business which may not be of interest to them. Which is where we've seen a number of families look at actually monetizing their family business and keeping aside the corpus into some structures, be it trusts, be it partnerships-based companies. All these structures are in short referred to as family offices. Now, there is no formal definition of a family office. It is just a more formalized structure to manage and preserve the family wealth. In most family offices, you would see situations where the income as well as the corpus is put in a structure wherein the wealth of the entire family is captured within one structure, rather than having individuals have their corpus in their individual name. One of the prime reasons why having assets in individual names is not considered extremely wise in the current situation is not only from a clear succession mechanism, wherein you could have a situation where a will may just be contested, but also from the perspective that a lot of families are extremely concerned about erosion of family wealth, which is where asset protection, both with respect to business risk as well as with respect to personal risk, be it matrimonial discord, etc., have become of absolute importance. Further, the designing of the structure takes into consideration several factors, such as dynamics of the family, the wealth under management, the risk appetite, the objectives of succession planning, etc. We've seen situations where families actually in their family offices, they run it absolutely as a corporate structure, have different divisions, not only with respect to investment management, with respect to philanthropy, or for that matter, with respect to just pure concierge services. And to that extent, have a structure which is, making it much more easy for the family to manage their wealth as well manage their personal affairs. Moon, may I request you to move to the next slide? So what is the popularity of family offices? Friends, you'll note that at least 3,000 single family offices exist worldwide, half of which have come into existence in the last 15 years. The relevance of this, I would say, is the fact that the last 15 or 20 years has really seen the rise of wealth amongst individuals. And because of the rise of the wealth, families have recognized that they do need to create adequate asset protection as well as succession structures so that the family as well as the succeeding generations are well protected with respect to wealth. Presently, as per documented numbers, India has only 45 formal family offices. Sorry, Mohan, if you could just go to the previous slide. It has only 45 formal family office structures, and this number is set to rise in the future. I would definitely say that, when we say 45 formal family office structures, the reason why they may be this low is only because they may actually not be calling themselves as family offices. But if we see a lot of the structures which promoters really have today, most of those structures are structures which essentially have all their investments being carried out through a separate entity. Whether they've named it formally as a family office or they are having their professionals who are running their businesses actually, run their investment structures too. These investment structures are nothing but family offices per se. Further, the reason why family offices become popular is because of the low cost of administration. Rather than paying third-party investment managers, brokers, real estate developers, that particular, those particular fees, what a lot of family offices would like to do is to essentially have all these functions moved in-house, wherein they are not only in control, but also with respect to confidentiality, the entire asset size as well as family dynamics are much more confidential in a family office structure. Other services that a lot of family offices like to undertake are essentially philanthropic activities, administering and implementing succession plans of the family, maybe through family constitutions, etc. Funding lifestyle needs, so be it maintenance, be it child education, healthcare, etc., be it insurance for that matter. And to that extent, a lot of educational activities or scholarship programs are often led by these family office structures. Mohan, please move on. When we really look at, from a family perspective, what are really the objectives of a family office and the importance which really, why families really prefer to have family offices? By some survey, it seems like the intergenerational wealth management, wherein rather than each individual taking their own call on how the wealth is going to be managed, like an individual A in the family may prefer to invest into, say, fixed income assets. Another family member may be wanting to take higher risk and invest into, say, pure venture capital or seed funding of ventures, etc. While certain others may look at moderate risk, such as private equity. What a lot of families believe that we rather have all these functions all captured within one structure, wherein you can actually diversify investment holding and have some proportion go into fixed income, some of it go into philanthropy, some of it go into private equity, venture capital, and so on and so forth. Another main objective behind family offices is really consolidation of administration function, be it accounting, be it tax, be it estate planning, etc. So you don't have situations where each particular family member will have their own accountant and their own lawyer, which may lead to conflicting views, and you actually house all these functions within one family office itself. Then, of course, a prime example, and I would say a prime objective of any of these family offices structures, is essentially maintaining the family as one family unit. Rather than having different family members essentially take their individual calls, you actually unify the entire structure by having all family members' wealth put into one family unit in itself. Then, of course, you have family education, healthcare, you have philanthropy, which becomes a very important and I would say an urgent need, especially for the Indian family, as well as life enhancement. And life enhancement essentially would mean the lifestyle which individuals in the family are expected to maintain, as well as to ensure that if you do have an outlier in the family who could be, a spendthrift, you are looking at situations where you are in a position to control these spendings by way of a family office structure. Please move on to the next one. The primary commercial considerations, as I would see it, are mainly four. One is preserving wealth for the future generation. And what we've seen in most Indian families, and most of y'all will agree, that when we actually work, to create some sort of wealth, most of the wealth is essentially created because we want to ensure that our subsequent generations have a comfortable lifestyle. And therefore, preservation of wealth becomes extremely important. The next is, of course, to ensure an intergenerational wealth transfer. And many of you all may be aware that very often, wherein individuals have passed away without leaving, formal wills or leaving, succession structures in place, you have situations where there may be family feuds and the entire matter sits in courts for 30 to 40 years. To ensure that the family actually benefits from these structures, it is extremely common nowadays to create family offices to ensure that the next generation is able to actually enjoy the wealth, without there being an erosion or a standstill because of a court issue. The next most important with respect to preservation, as I would see it, is essentially segregating the family business assets from family's personal assets. Now, most of you would agree, friends, that you would see situations where, as a promoter is essentially growing his business, he would often essentially have, you know, the residential house, you know, the cars which are for personal use, all essentially bought through business holding structures. And somewhere as these particular businesses grow, maybe by way of a listing, maybe by way of invitation to private equity, at that point in time, the promoter recognizes that he does need to segregate his own personal asset holding. Now, of course, you know, a lot of the frauds, financial frauds, which have taken place in the country, and I'm sure most of you know of all of them, you would see in most of those situations, the family as well as, you know, that individual continues to enjoy the same lifestyle as they did, you know, while, you know, prior to the fraud actually arising, where they essentially are showing that their business has totally gone, say, bankrupt, but at the end of it, their personal assets have been secured. These are situations where proper structures have been set up for this particular purpose. The next, I would say, a major commercial consideration is having a diversification of portfolio and deciding the main objective of investment. When we talk about diversification of portfolios, we're really referring to how much of an investment goes into portfolio management, how much goes into venture capital as well as startups, early stage investments, or impact investing, which is essentially social cause investing. On the other hand, you're talking about either philanthropy or you're essentially talking about just growth of the family business per se. And when we talk about growth of the family business, you know, you would notice that it's slightly conflicting, because in most situations, family offices are pools of capital which are essentially the personal wealth of the family. While on the other hand, the growth of the family business, whenever the family business may require some sort of capital, rather than approaching the bank, if at all the family office in itself does have some you know, capital which it can dispose, it may actually provide for either equity funding, debt funding, or a pure play loan to such businesses. The last, and I would say one of the most important, is family governance. Here it essentially is not only governance of the family business per se, but also maintaining some level of professional management as well as family management. Very often in family offices, you would see, you know, designations such as member of a family council, etc., which essentially means that if at all any family member has any concern or wants to essentially raise any issue with the family office with respect to certain, you know, personal issues or, you know, business issues which they are really facing, they can essentially approach the family office in itself and essentially get professional guidance on how to really manage themselves. Now, moving on to the next slide. The two different types of family offices which exist globally is one, a single family office, and the other, a multi-family office. A single family office is nothing but a family office wherein an individual promoter will essentially create a family office having its own professional advisors, real estate advisors, brokers, all of them be employees of the family office. Such a family office, the employees and the professionals which are housed within it are not permitted to actually advise any other family per se. On the other hand, a multi-family office, and you know, a lot of y'all would have seen the emergence of multifamily offices, you know, some of them being examples being, say, a Waterfield Advisor, which we have, you know, in Mumbai. It is essentially a multifamily office wherein certain families believe that they are too small, either by way of family members or either by way of family wealth, for them to actually create a separate family office structure. And therefore, what they essentially do, they outsource this particular function to a multi-family office. Now, here I would say that you know, a lot of families have essentially, you know, approached multi-family offices, you know, especially with respect to investment advisory, investment management. But a lot of them do not really prefer to go there merely because of confidentiality reasons, which is where they believe that, you know, we are not too sure whether, you know, our family investment portfolio, the ownership, the dynamics will all be maintained in a confidential manner. Moving on to the next slide. what are the pluses and the minuses of a single family offices versus a multi-family office? A single family office obviously operates on a much higher cost, but of course we're talking about a single family office where the stakes are much higher. And to that extent, you know, a lot of them will actually hire investment and managers from, you know, extremely successful private equity funds, have them, act internally, as well as they will have chartered accountants, lawyers, you know, company secretaries, all of them within the single family office framework. Obviously, all of this comes at a high cost. But to that extent, we have seen a lot of families consider a single family office, because as I mentioned, they find it, the stakes are too high for them to actually let go it to a multifamily office. On the other hand, the major benefit of a multifamily office, as I would put it, is the lower cost per family, especially because, you know, you may not really have, that much of a corpus to ensure that the professionals which you hire are engaged in that particular family office for the entire span of span of time. And therefore, at some times, you may prefer a multi-family office structure. Having said that, it is important to note that certain functions, like, and I would say one of the functions could just essentially be, say, concierge services, where, simple issues with respect to hotel bookings or with respect to travel or, for that matter, driver services, all of them can very easily be handled in a single family office structure, but extremely difficult in a multi-family office structure. Yeah. When we look at the type of investments really made by, family offices, we would see that most of the investments would be in equity, especially in India. And this is also because of the extremely buoyant capital markets which we have, wherein equity investments, especially in the public markets, is definitely something which is of great interest. The second essentially would be, the allocation would be towards real estate. And I would just say that is because of our social structure, wherein we as Indians, we just love to invest into real estate. The third essentially would be situations of fixed income. And these would essentially be fixed income, mutual funds, etc. And the reason why a lot of, importance is paid on investing into mutual funds is to ensure that there are fixed returns, being given, so that the needs and the lifestyle needs of the family can essentially be taken care of. A very close, next to the fixed income group is private equity. And, most of you all will be aware that private equity by nature is high risk, but also high return, which is where you would see a number of situations where families would want to invest in private equity, but they will ensure that they do not keep all their eggs in one basket and have some level of diversification also with respect to equity, real estate, fixed income, etc. And then, of course, you have gold, you have REIT structures, you have commodities, cash, etc., which is all essentially kept as the balance amount being invested into those structures. Let us look at some of the very prominent, family offices in India. And the only reason why we've put up these two is because both of them have really made waves in the type of investments which they have really made. Right? When we're looking at, a Premji Invest, which is essentially a family office of Azim Premji, it is a large family office which has an absolutely professional management team. If any of y'all have actually dealt with them, they can actually give any professional a run for their money because they're extremely thorough and they really know, they are very solid professionals who really know the rules of the game. So to that extent, when we're looking at family offices such as these, they have been extremely successful in making investments in certain ventures which may be mid-sized, such as Snapdeal, Policy Bazaar, Lenskart, etc. And you would be surprised to know that the assets which they have under management are upwards of $3 billion. Next, we have, Catamaran. And of course, it's important to know that Premji Invest has been structured as a private trust. And if whenever it does invest into any of these other, you know, private equity investments, it will always make investments through this private trust structure, wherein not only does it have, you know, some amounts being, you know, I mean, obviously it has a strict constitution, etc., but it also has some amount being, you know, being contributed into charity. Next comes Narayan Murthy with Catamaran Ventures. And interestingly, this structure has been, you know, this family office has been structured as a limited liability partnership. It is a much smaller, I would say, management team. And you would, you know, we would see that it is, you know, the assets under management are just around $300 million. Here we've seen the type of, you know, investments which it has made. It has been in Amazon's Cloudtail, Wellspring Healthcare, the Manipal Group, etc. Narayan Murthy's family office very often invests into, you know, very often invests into, I would say, you know, seed capital and venture capital funding. A lot of you may wonder that why has there really been a difference in the structure which, you know, an Premji Invest as a private trust has undertaken as well as a Catamaran Venture. Now, one of the prime reasons I would say here, Moin, can you please shift to the next slide, please? Sorry. Okay, so one of the main reasons I would say is that when you're looking at a trust structure, it provides a high level of confidentiality because these trusts do not need to be compulsory registered. And to that extent, the names of the beneficiaries can actually be kept confidential, you know, vis-a-vis third party. On the other hand, an LLP structure, just a simple MCA search will actually bring out all the names of the partners. Now, having said that, an LLP structure is a structure wherein you can actually invest outside of India. And a number of you may be aware that Catamaran Ventures has made a lot of overseas investments. And perhaps that was the thought process within which it actually set themselves up as an LLP, as opposed to actually setting it up as a trust, because a trust per se cannot invest outside of India. Let's look at the other prominent family offices structures in India. One is, of course, the Ratan Tata Associates. And I would say this is one, you know, this has been formed in the nature of a company. And a very big amount of wealth of the R&T associates has actually gone into UC R&T Fund, which is an alternate investment fund, which is formed as a joint venture between R&T associates as well as University of California. Very interestingly, they are again making a lot of venture capital and private equity investments. And to that extent, if we see this, you know, with respect to R&T associates, it's more of a combination of a company as well as a trust structure. And to that extent, you know, that blend which they have actually undertaken is very interesting to really see. The next we really have is Ronnie Screwvala, which is Unilaser Ventures. Again, here we are looking at the structure which is in the form of a company and which was later registered as an NBFC. And of course, Moin will in the later slides, you know, explain the regulatory climate around the entire NBFC. When Ronnie Screwvala's, you know, family office focuses on impact investing, a lot of private equity, media, etc. are the ones which Ronnie Screwvala has really invested in. And of course, you have, you know, even some movies, which Bollywood movies of fame, which have been funded by the Unilaser family office. Then, of course, the Dabur family office, which is the Berman family. Again, this is in the form of a company. And what is most important to note is that though the, you know, though the family office may be in the form of a company, a lot of them may not be owned by individuals and they may actually be layered through trust structures so that there is a smooth succession of wealth. Some of the interesting investments which they have made would be Aviva Insurance, would be RBL Bank, M3, and the size out here is around 500 million of assets under management. And then you have the Narottam Saxeria Foundation. This is essentially the family office of, you know, the Saxeria Group. And a number of you may be aware that the Saxaria, Narottam Saxaria Foundation, or rather the family office, has been formed through a monetization of the promoter holding in Ambuja Cement. And to that extent, this family office has been structured in the form of a company. But again, as I mentioned, that they do have a number of, you know, trusts which would be in the picture, etc., depending on the needs of the family itself. Again, when you look at the Narottam Saxaria Foundation, a very prominent, venture which they have housed within the family office is the scholarship program, wherein they have young students who want to go abroad for education. They actually provide for a loan scholarship to such students. It's an extremely successful program. And we've seen, the family offices have a wide range of activities, as we just mentioned here. Moving on to the next. So just looking at the legal structures of family offices, a family office may be set up in the form of a trust, a company, or a limited liability partnership. In a trust, especially because of the tax considerations under Section 56, only family members can be, can be beneficiaries vis-a-vis, being the relative definition, to the settlor. There is a great deal of investment flexibility without much restriction, for the simple reason that, such family office or investment trust structures have not yet been regulated by either, either by the Reserve Bank of India or by the SEBI. Important to note that if any of these family offices which are set up in the form of a trust would like to take in a third party capital, then in that situation, it would essentially be a situation where such a family office would invest into, say, an alternate investment fund and have the joint venture partner also be a co-contributor. Important to note that if at all any sort of a trust or any sort of an entity, approaches third party capital, or is making a placement on a private placement basis and is encouraging third parties to invest, then in that situation, such structures would need to get in the registration as an alternate investment fund. A trust, as all of you all will be aware, has a pass-through under the income tax law, because the trust per se is not a separate taxable entity. Some family office structures are structured as corporate. And, it's not very ideal, especially because, some of them may trigger an NBFC registration. Again, the taxation, can be highly tax inefficient. And as I mentioned, in the beginning, a corporate and an LLP structure per se, because of, not being able to maintain confidentiality of the shareholders or the partners, is sometimes a big concern to family members per se. Very close compared to a corporate structure, I would say, is the LLP structure. And in the LLP structure, again, the downside is just confidentiality. But the taxation, of course, is only at one level and distributions are not taxable. Compared to a corporate structure, an LLP per se may have lesser compliances. But of course, the Reserve Bank of India has caught into these LLP structures, trying to carry on NBFC-linked activities. And to that extent, there is it's not that easy to actually register an investment LLP as such. When you're looking at, all of this was with respect to onshore family offices in the sense of structure. Globally, a lot of family offices have actually been set up, and a lot of jurisdictions are encouraging Indian families to essentially set up their family offices outside of India. Now, what are the considerations which families look at while they're choosing a jurisdiction where they should set up their family office? And one point which I would definitely say is that families choose to set up global family offices or offshore family offices only in situations where they have a desire to have offshore wealth, in the sense of, they have global investment, as well as their family is a multi-global family. Only in such situations to families consider actually having a structure also outside of India. The considerations obviously are tax, the legal system, the ease of operations, as well as the investment, the investment options really available. On the tax side, I mean, it's, obvious that, families will look at a tax neutral jurisdiction. But of course, it's important to know that any of these structures will have to have professional teams of management outside of India to ensure that there is no sort of a poem risk. And, the family wealth is essentially protected. Gone are the days where families really want to create any sort of an opaque tax structure. Especially after the leaks, families rather have a transparent structure, especially given the FATCA as well as the CRS regulation. The next coming about, I would say, is the legal system. You generally want to enter a legal system which is similar in form to India in the sense of a common law country. But at the same, time, you want to have a regulation which has ease of repatriation. There are no exchange controls. It is easy to structure, easy to set up, etc. And of course, most important, you want to have a legal system which has a very strong, court system. If at all there is an unfortunate event of any family member having an issue with respect to the family office and its function, then in that situation, they are able to approach the court. Then, of course, the structure and operations, as well as the investments in the sense of ease of banking operations, etc. Going to the next slide. The preferred jurisdiction which we've seen for Indian families, and, a lot of you would agree with me that most Indian families would like to set up their offshore entities in jurisdictions which they can actually feel and touch and actually visit. And which is why if we see Hong Kong and Singapore turn out to be the most popular jurisdictions because it's just a flight away. When we really look at these jurisdictions, Hong Kong obviously being like perhaps the financial center of the Asia-Pac region is a very popular jurisdiction for family offices. But we have seen a significant amount of questions, especially because come 2047, Hong Kong, when it becomes a part of China, which is where Indian families may not really want to have, structures which are regulated by, the Chinese regulatory authority. Then, of course, you have Singapore and, a lot of family offices have been set up in Singapore, and Singapore is, marketing the entire family office regime, quite a bit. And the traditional jurisdictions, I would say, and perhaps the ones which are more popular amongst non-Indian families would essentially be Jersey, Switzerland, UK. And I would say Jersey and Switzerland would be the ones which trump, not because of being low tax jurisdictions or not because of confidentiality or opaque structures, but more from the perspective that these are jurisdictions which have had family offices, trust structures in existence for years together, and therefore their judicial thinking on these particular structures is extremely well established. And to that extent, for a lot of non-Indian families, we would essentially see Jersey, Switzerland, as well as the UK be prominent jurisdictions. Moin, if you could move to the next. Yeah, this is just, on the choice of jurisdiction as to what becomes the most important. And, we will see that the most important criteria is a stable legal and political environment. Like, a lot of you, would be aware of, the entire Kuwait crisis, where you had a lot of Indian families who had to actually just, in a couple of hours, just pack their bags and return to the country. A lot of them actually lost a lot of wealth, which is where a lot of families have become extremely cognizant of the fact that a stable political environment becomes the core of any family office structure with respect to stability, as well as to have it available for a number of years. Interestingly, it is not that important from a tax perspective. So if you see when their families are choosing jurisdictions, tax does not become as important as a stable legal and political environment is. Then, of course, proximity to family members. And this is, you know, simply stated because Indian families would like to visit that particular trustees or visit the members of the family office, etc. The availability of supporting financial services. And I would say this is important, but perhaps not as important for the simple reason that a lot of families recognize that, you know, with the globalization of financial services, irrespective of whichever jurisdiction you are sitting in, you can always offshore that particular financial service requirement to another jurisdiction. Moving on to the next slide. So the question really arises that should you opt for a family office? One is, of course, the offshore regime, it does offer political and legal certainty. And especially in situations where families may be global and assets are really diversely spread, family offices outside of India may offer some benefits. Of course, the remittances could be made under the, regimes, but it may not be a sizable amount which Indian families may want to actually, remit. On the negatives, you, of course, have a higher cost of administration establishment. Therefore, it is important to actually create these structures only if at all you have a significant amount of corpus to be created. A lot of jurisdictions like Singapore, Jersey, they provide for a lot of advantages or a lot of benefits, I would say, to family offices set up there. However, all these family offices do require a minimum size. Just as an example, if you're looking at Singapore, the minimum size as a requirement to get the benefits of the regime is essentially a $50 million amount. And you would appreciate that for under the FEMA regulations, to have a $50 million remittance is going to be taking ages for a family to actually remit. And to that extent, it is not really that easy. Moving on to the next slide. So treasury management and, this has become a very, very important, facet and role of family offices. This is essentially like, a treasury which sits within any, say, bank. A family office's major role is treasury management. Whenever there is a crisis or a liquidity crunch amongst family businesses, a lot of these businesses will actually, look to the treasury management group to ensure that their liquidity is essentially maintained. Mohit, please move to the next. And of course, it becomes a group financing function, especially given the corporate, the corporate law restrictions on group financing. Very often, these type of family offices actually come to the rescue. Now, friends, I would request, my colleague Moen, who is our partner and a senior member of, the regulatory regulatory group in Khaitan, to actually give flavor on the entire NBFC, SEBI, CIC guidelines. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Bijal, and good afternoon, everybody. So I think starting from the topic of, sort of using NBFCs, we'll directly get to the concept of how an NBFC is used as a family office, plus what are the challenges really when you are carrying on such activity for your treasury operations, etc. So just to start off, I mean, there are certain basic details of an NBFC and how we would get categorized as an NBFC, which I'll get into. So while there is a clear definition of what entities would amount to an NBFC, and it also refers to financial business in Section 45IA of the Reserve Bank of India Act, the real issue is testing the principal business and seeing where the actual revenue is arising from. So in a scenario where your 50% of your assets and your revenue are both from financial assets, in which case you get categorized as a non-banking financial company. As soon as you are categorized as a non-banking financial company, and assuming you've used this as a structure to set up your family office or to house your family office and your investment structure for the family, there are a couple of challenges. While we do advise and are working with many of the existing structures. Today, when you are setting up a new business or a new structure and approaching the Reserve Bank for a registration on these grounds, the Reserve Bank is quite adamant and is looking for a lot of business related details, to which we do tell them that, you know, the requirement is prescribed under the law, and hence, you know, we are approaching for the registrations. But there are a lot of resistance from a Reserve Bank perspective to set up a company which is purely only for the purpose of holding certain investment and does not in reality carry on actual business. And therefore, if you see, a few years ago, they have also come up with the concept of a core investment company, which is specifically focused only on investments into the group company and not getting into any other activity, which we will deal obviously separately. But I mean, moving on to what really is to be considered if you are looking at an NBFC as a structure for your family office, is one is whether you are having a sophisticated structure enough to be able to comply with all the prudential norms, whether you have set appropriate policies and surveillance in place. Because I, you know, while I'm talking about these you know, regulations, I've thought of giving you a few more examples on each of this area. So we've just seen a few scenarios where a lot of these family holding structures have been questioned and there has been a lot of trouble. One of the specific issues is that because these are only holding family shares, one has not paid as much attention to whether they have complied with their net own fund requirement, whether they have actually been compliant with their prudential norms, whether transactions with a group company are being done on an arm's length basis and appropriate disclosures are being made, whether you've gone ahead and made a suspicious transaction related registration with the intelligence unit. So a lot of these things and a lot of these issues continue to subsist for several years. And over the last 1 or 2 years, we've seen that about 9,000 companies RBI notified as high-risk financial institutions, merely because they had not registered under the FIU system for reporting suspicious transactions. We've seen many NBFCs which became systemically important, because the day you set up your family office, your asset size may not be as large, but over a period of time, when you're investing and growing, it could substantially increase. And you know, Bijal did mention that some of the family offices are really, really large, and therefore they even beat the threshold of 500 crore Indian rupees and become systemically important NBFCs. The moment they become systemically important NBFCs, what becomes relevant also is to examine whether that is impacting any other companies in the group which are NBFCs. Because once an entity becomes systemically important in one group, it takes under its umbrella all the other entities, and all the compliances and additional surveillance mechanisms become applicable to you. The second thing is that some of these inter-group transactions or funding transactions that are being undertaken through NBFCs are being structured in particular unique ways because it is between the group. So we've seen instances where RBI has questioned NBFCs why interest was not mentioned in the document, why interest is not being charged, why loans are being settled at the end of March or just before the end of March and restarted in April. So there has been extreme amount of difficulties even for normal NBFCs. So I'll just share an example. We were advising a client who was looking at listing. And because they were going for their IPO, they had to consider which were the entities that were getting categorized as a promoter group entity to bring in the minimum capitalization of promoters for lock-in of 3 years. They found that because they were holding their majority of the promoter holding through a holding family office entity. So this entity was an unlisted entity, which was an NBFC. The only job it was doing was holding the shares in this entity, which was now looking for listing. And therefore, though it was not systemically important, though it was privately controlled, no exposure to public, no public deposit, it went on to SEBI, that these are the entities, and because they were looking at going for an IPO, SEBI had to consult with the Reserve Bank of India, and Reserve Bank of India started digging deep into the details. And what was realized is that
this entity was being
used by the group for doing transactions and funding, but they were only doing transactions which were not getting reflected at the end of the month, but very quickly in the beginning of April, they would restate those loans. So the questions that RBI asked, which they would have never expected, was that what was the purpose of you repaying the loan at the end of March and bringing it back in April? Second issue was that no one had paid attention to net owned funds. So again, another issue we saw that over, just about mid of last year, we've seen about 200 to 300 companies in Kolkata, which was the hub where most of the NBFCs existed, were getting cancelled on a daily basis because of NOF not being complied. Now that's a small amount of 2 crores, but the calculation is so technical, which you would also, you guys would know it better than me, is that it gets adjusted because of other transactions and other group related transactions. So RBI raised questions to the auditors, how they had missed it. Now auditors were not looking at it very carefully because it was a small, privately owned entity having just one or two assets. So this investigation as we speak is continuing. And therefore, it is becoming very, very important that, after all these frauds of ILNFS in the world, one has to be more and more careful of how financial service entities like NBFCs, regulated entities, are being handled. So that investigation still continues. And, as they dig deeper, they are able to find a lot more detail and something that they would have never expected. That has become a roadblock for being able to go to the market because SEBI will not approve the document until that is done. The next concept that RBI introduced to sort of aid situations like this is their core investment companies. These companies are particularly companies which are a better option. There are two categories. One is systemically important. One is non-systemically important. Non-systemically important does not even need to obtain a registration from the RBI. So it's basically a company. And I'll try to explain this specifically because I will get to a particular set of questions, which are some interesting questions that RBI has answered, which in a way are leading to some very different thought processes. So first thing is that you have to be a non-banking financial company, which has 90% or more of its assets in group companies, in the form of investment in group companies. And you can have about 60% in equity shares of group companies or in units of an InvITs as a sponsor. Now, the only transaction that you are allowed to do is by way of block for divestment or dilution. So that could be a legal requirement. So one example is if you are in a listed company and your promoter shareholding exceeds a certain number, 75%, you have to dilute it. Now, apart from that, they cannot undertake any other activity. And to be able to continue as an exempt category core investment company, you need to have two conditions to be not fulfilled. First is that your asset, to become a systemically important core investment company, two conditions have to be fulfilled. The first condition is that you have asset size of more than 100 crores and you are accessing public funds. So assuming you have an asset size of 500 crores and you're not accessing public funds, then you will not be construed as a core investment company. Now, what amounts to public funds is a very interesting issue again in the context of CICs. Even a car loan that you would have taken for some of your directors. So any bank finance is also construed as a public fund. So that is another issue that the definition is very, very wide. The second issue is that what is it that the 10% could be? One would say that 90% I will invest in the group companies, but what is it that I can do for that 10%? So that is an issue which we'll come to when we look at the questions. But it's not another business altogether, but you could do only activities that are supportive of your core investment business. So for example, you may need an office space for carrying on your activity. That is something you can continue to do, but not something that is completely out of the financial business. So it's only your fixed assets or your real estate for your functioning, but you cannot go and start investing in other companies, etc. Now, why do people still not choose core investment companies? Before we get to the specific questions, is that the main aim of these family offices is to invest. And as Bijal also clarified, that listed companies and listed markets or real estate are the opportunities we like to explore because of the buoyancy of our market plus our interest in real estate investments. Both of them are a roadblock, because suppose I want to invest in listed companies of another group where there is a great opportunity, I will not be able to do that, because the problem will then be that I will not meet this criteria. And what happens if a CIC, which is taken exemption from registration, does not meet this criteria? It becomes an NBFC and it has to go back and get a registration from the Reserve Bank. Now, assuming you've crossed the threshold, you have to obtain a registration as a systemically important NBFC. And systemically important NBFC almost is akin to a registered NBFC. Systemically important core investment companies are almost akin to a registered NBFC. Now, there are a few sort of questions which are very interesting, which I thought I should bring out. So there, and I will also refer when I bring these out to certain FAQs and questions that the Reserve Bank has specifically dealt with in the context of a core investment company. So the first issue is that as a core investment company, do I need to meet the principal business test? What I mean by this is that, do I need to meet the test of having more than 50% financial assets and more than 50% of my gross income coming from financial assets? So the question before the Reserve Bank and the specifically is, and I'm focusing on this because the next question, this is going to be very relevant, is that if a company has invested in its group, but it is not meeting the criteria of principal business, which is the 50-50 test, can it be registered as a CIC, or does it need to first get registered as a NBFC? So here RBI has said that the core investment company need not meet the principal business criteria. So this has sort of led to a possible conclusion that even though you're not an NBFC, but just because your investment looks like you have invested in the group companies, you could be a core investment company. Now we hold that thought and we go to the next question, whether a holding company which does not meet the core investment company criteria required to comply with NBFC requirements if it does not satisfy the 50-50 test. What this question really implies is that suppose I am an entity which does not have more than 50% financial asset and do not receive more than 50% of my revenue from financial assets, but I also don't meet the criteria for registration, or don't meet the criteria for core investment companies, which is 90% of your assets being invested in the group, do I need to do anything at all? To which RBI has said that no, you do not need to register, and you would need to register only if you have crossed that threshold. So basically, if this company is not meeting the 50-50 test here, it does not need to register, is what RBI has said. But in the previous question, RBI has mentioned that if you are not meeting 50-50 test but meeting core investment company conditions, you will continue as a core investment company. So there is a little bit of disconnect here, if you are not an NBFC, whether you at all need to go and examine the test, and whether you need to go and at all try to fulfill any conditions so far as a core investment company is concerned. This is the issue. Now, can these investment companies and NBFCs invest abroad, and do they need to take a permission from the RBI? So there are specific regimes applicable for NBFCs and CICs. So if you want to diversify your investment abroad, as an NBFC, you would need to take an approval irrespective of the sector you're investing in. But as a core investment company, you would need an approval only if you're investing in a financial sector overseas. Plus, the issue will be that if you are an exempt core investment company and you want to invest abroad, you would also need to first obtain registration as a systemically important entity, and only then will you be permitted to make any such overseas direct investment. Another issue that we have seen is that, you know, when, and we have actually seen this multiple times actually over the last couple of years, when your, you know, structure was initially a company and that structure has become sizable now, and then there are discussions of fears around estate duty or any possible tax, wealth tax becoming applicable, people started exploring the concept of, you know, going back to the trust structure, which, as Bijal mentioned, brings additional advantages of not being regulated, or also sort of, you know, having a continuing structure. It's more stable. There is a trust. So there's a trustee who decides how this functioning will be. There's a lot of confidentiality and there's stability. Even if one or two family members are not in sync, it can at least control the economic benefits to them. In such scenarios, the question that arises that when I transfer my shareholding of the NBFC into a trust or settle it into a trust, and I continue to be a trustee along with another family member, would that really amount to a change in control? So this issue we have dealt with in a few cases, and I'll also tell you what has been the outcome. See, the first response really is that because this is a transaction between all family members, and there is no real change or no introduction of a third party, whether there is at all a question of any change in control, all of us will agree that in reality, there will not be change in control. There could be change in management. I could avoid that also if I don't change the board. But the Reserve Bank's view has been, and in terms of this circular, that there are three categories when you need to obtain approval. The first category is when there is an actual change in control or acquisition of control. The second category is when you have any change in shareholding that would result in change of more than 26% of the paid up equity. And the third category is any change in management, which would be more than 30% of the directors, excluding the independent directors. So in effect, the transfer to trust is looked at as a change for the purposes of this approval requirement. And both in case of core investment companies and NBFCs, one does need to go and obtain approval. Now, the scenarios we've seen is that because of certain time sensitivity, the transactions were done by the parties and transfers to the trust were already concluded. And the question really was that what happens now, to which we went back and made representations to the RBI and explained them that, you know, this was really a transaction with no interface or exposure to public, and therefore the process that is required to be followed should not be followed. But we did accept the fact that technical requirement of approval was not met, and therefore we actually sought a post facto taking on record approval from the Reserve Bank of India. The conditions that they were getting comfort with is that it was a family trust, no third party involved. The beneficiaries continue to be the same family. The trustees continue to be same family members, but there was no layering. So they were actual individual trustees. The other feedback that we got is that in such NBFCs, because they are continuing as registered NBFCs, no doubt that maybe one or two shareholders were controlling this in entirety. You need to have a better governance structure, and you need to appoint other professional directors as independent directors to be able to ensure that it is actually run as a licensed financial entity and not being run as its own set of treasury, which may grant or receive back payments for loans as they like at their own whim and fancy without complying with the arm's length norms and other policies. So that, and the other feedback we got is that all these NBFCs which are being run by family offices or which are being privately run as structures for holding shares of a particular set of promoters, all of them need to ensure that appropriate compliances, policies, paperwork, etc. is kept in place, because there could be potentially any inspection, any review, and, you know, in such instances where there are changes that you need to go back to them for, those times is when RBI gets an opportunity to really dig in more detail and pick up sort of questions really around these things, you know. So I think that is the coverage I wanted to give, and will be happy to subsequently take questions on how NBFCs and core investment companies can be used as a structure. I will now move on to considerations under the SEBI and FEMA. So far as you know, overseas investments or structures are set up or done by the family offices. Another very interesting issue that we have come across is especially for larger groups of families who have housed their holdings in listed companies into such holding entities, is that now I'll try to build up a bit of why and where we are coming from. See, the first aspect is that in a listed company, there are certain thresholds that have been prescribed. The moment you have crossed those thresholds, you have to obtain a specific exemption or make a mandatory tender offer. So the first threshold that has been prescribed is 25% of voting rights being acquired in a listed company by a single individual or along with certain persons acting in concert. The next thing is, if you, along with your promoters, other promoters, cross the 5% threshold in a particular financial year, you need to make an offer. So this is called the creeping threshold. Third is the acquisition of control. And the fourth is acquiring control indirectly. So control obviously may not be very relevant because this is a company that is controlled by a promoter. And therefore the promoters will continue to be in control. The issue of creeping could become relevant depending on how much percentage of shares are getting transferred to the trust. Plus the issue of 25% could also become relevant depending on what shareholding is getting transferred, because in India we have promoter shareholding capped at 75%, so it's very likely that the transfer to trust could be more than 25%. The other aspect is indirectly. So suppose you had a unlisted company which held shares in a listed company, and you have another entity which holds the shares of such unlisted company. So if you're doing transfer a layer above, you still could indirectly transfer the, cross these thresholds. So the question really was that a trust is effectively nothing but an obligation annexed ownership. And if it is created for the benefit of the same promoters who are actually holding currently, and is sort of, the trustee also is one of the same promoter or their actual immediate relative, then is there any problem, and whether any general exemption could be availed? So the general exemptions that were possibly available were that any transfer between family members or between the existing promoter group named for 3 years, all of that would be possible. And the question before SEBI was that whether such transfers would be permitted under the general exemption route, or whether SEBI will look at a trust as an independent set of formation because of the flexibility and confidentiality associated with it, whether they will look at it as a separate setup, to which SEBI preferred the latter approach. SEBI actually took a position that even though the trustee, who is the actual legal owner as per the Trust Act, and who has the ownership of the shares, is a relative or an eligible exempted transferee who could have availed general exemption, merely because they are actually acting as a trustee, who will have to come to us for a specific exemption. It also came out with a set of circulars, a set of exemption orders, and came out with a guiding circular, which provided clarity on what would be considered when they are looking at such exemptions. And I'm just quickly going to run through this because it is very relevant. If we are looking at transfer of any unlisted company shares which happens to hold shareholding in a listed company, this is relevant. If we are looking at settling any assets of any family office into a trust subsequently, it becomes again relevant to see what is the percentage of listed company investment, and if at all there is any controlling position, how that will be handled. So the points that SEBI came up with is that the trust should in substance only be a mirror image. So it should not really be a backdoor entry for any other third party. It should be the same set of individuals who continue to be the beneficiaries and the trustees. Only individual promoters or their immediate relatives and lineal descendants can be the beneficiaries and trustees. They wanted parties to undertake that they will not assign or encumber their rights as trustees or beneficiaries in the trust in any manner. And, you know, also they said that any sort of change would have to be reported to SEBI. And lastly, no specific primary functions could be delegated. Only certain administrative functions is what they got comfortable with. And SEBI started to give specific exemption. Even though the trustees were otherwise eligible, but because they became part of a trust and they were not acting in their individual capacity, SEBI took a view that you had to take exemption, and they have granted those exemptions. Now, the next aspect I wanted to move to was on the overseas investment routes. We did discuss about overseas investments by family offices, and also we discussed about setting up offices itself outside India. And for that purpose, it's relevant how one can set up a structure abroad, what are the possible options available, and what are the sort of, you know, prohibitions. So one thing is very clear that, you know, banking business, you know, real estate business, and certain, you know, dealings in financial products linked to INR, all of these are not sort of permitted for setting up companies abroad. And also these kind of structures would require approval. So we'll break this up into two parts now. One is the investments through resident individuals abroad for smaller groups where smaller offices or smaller structures are being created. And the second aspect is through their Indian companies or through Indian family offices trying to diversify abroad. So the first aspect really is that if you are a resident individual and you want to invest, there are very limited entry points available, which we will discuss when we go to the concept of liberalized remittance scheme and transaction permitted as part of that scheme. As far as companies investing, if they are investing in a bona fide business structure, no problem. It is under the automatic route. There are certain limits prescribed. But if you are setting up a family office or a structure to diversify investments abroad, you would generally want to be able to do financial service activities. And the moment you want to do financial service activities, there are certain conditions that become applicable to you. The first is that you yourself, the Indian entity itself, which wants to invest, will have to be engaged in financial activity in India and therefore be licensed. So you would be either a core investment company or an NBFC licensed in India. You should have a track record of 3 years of profit. You would need to obtain a no objection certificate from the entity or regulatory authority from which who you have obtained registration in India, and also from the relevant authority, if at all there is one abroad, that would be applicable. And then these entities will be able to do the business of investments abroad. Even if you set up a step-down entity, that same requirement for approval will become applicable. Unregulated entities in India have also tried to set up companies in financial sector sometimes, but I can tell you that RBI is not at all keen and does not grant such approvals. What they can do is just go with their other businesses, but that may not work if you want an investment structure abroad. Another situation we've seen is you set up such investment structure abroad. And because India is such an interesting market, you know, at one place we are seeing that FPIs are bailing out, but we've also seen a record number of FPIs registering with SEBI this month. So effectively, you see, India is a very interesting market, and it's got growth potential. So there could be a sort of a position where your entity that you've set up abroad may look at reinvesting into an Indian business, maybe not necessarily your own business, but another opportunity. Or it may look at investing in an overseas entity abroad, which happens to have an India connection. And the third category could be that it invests into a fund which happens to have an India focus and which is investing in Indian assets or sort of India or sort of providing capital to Indian companies in some manner or the other. To deal with this, RBI had and the government has been frowning upon what is called as round tripping. And for a long time, they have been requiring parties to take an approval for undertaking this transaction to examine whether there is any transaction which is not a genuine bona fide transaction and is only involving flow of money from one jurisdiction to another, or in some sort of a tax evasion transaction. And for that, in just about last year, RBI actually came out with a FAQ which specifically clarified this position that if you are having an Indian connection in your investment structure, you will need to have a prior approval of the Reserve Bank. One would certainly question the binding value of an FAQ because these are just directions or clarifications to the law. But RBI has passed orders and even compounding orders to this effect on the ground that an investment back into India will not constitute as a bona fide business investment, and therefore one needs to obtain a prior approval when they're doing this investment. Now moving on to liberalized remittance scheme, where we will also deal with how overseas investments can be undertaken by individuals. Now here, to actually set up or to create a corpus for your family office or otherwise for your family in another jurisdiction, there are a couple of options available. And I'd like you to focus on one specific option that is, I think, in the permitted activities. There is bullet number 3, which specifically mentions that making investments abroad in acquisition of shares in listed or unlisted companies. And then there is a subsequent entry which says setting up of a wholly owned subsidiary and JV abroad. So now the issue really is that the position that has been taken in this regard is even though there are two separate entries for investments under the LRS scheme, even after 2013, the position given the definition of the word joint venture under the overseas investment norms and the way overseas direct investment is looked at, any investment that you make abroad is getting constituted as a joint venture because it says any holding by an Indian resident abroad constitutes as a joint venture for that particular Indian resident. Prior to 2013, in the definition of Indian party did not include an Indian individual and it did not allow an Indian individual to do overseas direct investment. What was allowed is the investments under LRS scheme. And though that's, I would want to go back and show you that it actually mentioned specifically unlisted, the position taken in that actually only intended for investments in which are portfolio in nature and are in listed stocks or in entities which are more in the nature of a public company and not for purposes of private companies. A very interesting position here I would like to mention is that sometime in 2010, they also came out with an FAQ to say that an Indian resident individual cannot set up a wholly owned subsidiary abroad under the LRS scheme. To which what a lot of people did is that they did not actually set up, but they got some administrator or some service provider to set up. And then bought the shares. And they said that, technically we have not set up any company abroad. We've just bought shares. But starting around mid-2009-10, we've seen many situations where RBI questioned the holdings. People were required to divest those holdings and were required to, also do a settlement by way of compounding with the Reserve Bank of India. In 2013, RBI said, no problem. It's fine. We will allow you to go ahead and make investments, by way of JV or WS under the LRS scheme, but they came out with multiple processes and requirements. And the reason such a structure won't work for a family office or from an investment structure is that such entities which are formed by an individual by investing abroad, such entities are subject to restrictions. And one of the restrictions is that these companies cannot invest in other subsidiaries. So they can never have step down subsidiaries. So they can only be an in business operation. It cannot be some entity which is doing investments. So therefore, it does not meet that criteria. Plus, these entities cannot be engaged in the financial services business. So therefore, really speaking, from a if one was to look at diverse investing in an operation or a bona fide business abroad, it would work, but it would not really work in the context of a investment structure. That really brings us to the question that therefore under LRS scheme, one cannot set up a family office abroad. Plus, one cannot set up a structure for investments abroad. Then what can one do? And what happens to people who have been investing? The question is still untested, because if someone has already been investing, most people we've noticed have accepted RBI's position and gone and done a settlement. But one needs to think what would happen if one was to contest that provision under the LRS scheme, which is a specific entry that says that you can invest in unlisted companies and justify to RBI that it is a portfolio investment. That would be an interesting position to see. The second question is that all along when we spoke of NBFCs, core investment companies, and setting up companies abroad, we did not speak of LPs or trusts. So I want to, in some manner touch upon these aspects also. So far as a trust is concerned, a trust is could be set up, and as reminding you what Bijal mentioned, it brings a lot of confidentiality, it brings a lot of flexibility. You cannot find out who the owners are, who the beneficiaries are, who the trustees are, but the issue here is that LRS scheme allows you to donate money. It allows you to make a gift or donation to relatives or to organizations outside India. The question therefore is that can one take a position that can I gift out money to a trust overseas, which is set up, and that trust effectively does my business of investment. If one was to think of it, effectively you are trying to achieve something which you are specifically not allowed to achieve under these schemes. So in effect, one could question whether this is really a donation or whether it's sort of an investment in some form or the other. So that is another interesting aspect to think about. And the second aspect of an LLP is that while today existing legacy LLPs are doing the investment business because they're very conveniently placed, they're not required to register as NBFCs as we speak today. But are these LLPs really able to carry on financial business is a question. So what we have learned is that when you're registering new LLPs and you're mentioning your main core activity as financial activity, there is a certain amount of challenge in terms of, getting that registration done. And therefore, what I'm hearing is that a lot of these operating registered LLPs are actually doing treasury or investment related activity and business. So that is something that could at some point backfire, and one will need to see how that and what that could lead to. This is a quick sort of, snapshot we tried to do. But, as I mentioned to you, that LRS scheme can be used for various purposes, but it's not functional if one was to create an investment structure through a company abroad. Even if one was to do it through a trust, I did mention what could be the potential issues. But that is one window people would have explored, because it does allow you to make donations to a trust. The other issue I thought I'll touch upon is that you see a lot of family offices look at investment opportunities even abroad for various purposes. including sometimes for some business diversification purposes or as part of their investment venture overseas or for use of the family members, etc. Now, there are a couple of issues that one needs to think of. One way to do it is under the LRS scheme, but that may not satisfy substantial acquisition or larger property acquisitions, or may help for smaller ones, because when we talk of the 250,000 annual limit, it's a limit driven by not just a single individual. You could try to combine it with your family members. And therefore, if there are four family members, you could easily achieve a $1 million limit. But you will need to be a joint owner in that property. Another way that people have been looking at is using companies to invest. And when companies are investing, they are investing in an entity abroad, which has to be an entity which is engaged in a bona fide business. Now, what is bona fide business? Because just to recall, we did discuss that real estate business is something that is specifically prohibited. So that is that would ideally be trading in real estate, but there is no clarity on whether acquiring a property merely for leasing would also qualify as real estate business. I can share with you that there is some discussion around this, and there could potentially be clarification soon that an entity which is engaged in the business of merely leasing out properties is not really to be considered as engaged in real estate business. But until that happens, having a standalone property overseas in a foreign company which you've set up as a JV or a wholly owned subsidiary is by itself questionable, because that is not a bona fide business. And the only other way I've seen where properties have been acquired and are subsisting is for actual use by directors or for purpose of expanding your business abroad. When, you know, if you're traveling frequently for a certain business, etc., or developing your business in that jurisdiction. So one will need to demonstrate all those things. That will actually have to be the position if a property is being acquired under this rule. The other concept which we have seen prevalent is sometimes there are certain individuals from the family who decide to move out and get based in another jurisdiction. There are multiple things, and I've put only gift on the slide, but I'll try to mention a few more other things. So, you know, what effectively happens is that when you move out as a resident of another jurisdiction, and there could be different points to this, all your current holding becomes non-repatriable, whatever you had acquired with your Indian funds as an Indian. Plus, your accounts get converted into non-resident ordinary account with a limit of $1 million remittance every year. Also, there are scenarios where, you know, there could be possibly a gift or some sort of transaction between the family members after a change in this position. So here, if you are as a resident wanting to gift your shares to a non-resident family member, there is a requirement for an approval. There is also a requirement that it can't exceed 5% of the share capital of the relevant entity. And the limit is $50,000. So it really is a very small limit, and it may not, you know, necessarily fulfill the conditionality. Also, I can share that RBI is not keen to allow any such transfers beyond these limits, even if one was to approach for a specific approval. On the other hand, if an NRI is transferring to an NR, depending on certain categories and certain conditionalities, there would again be a requirement for a sort of, you know, approval, depending on what sector this is engaged in and what really is a, whether that sector is a automatic route sector or whether that sector is something that's highly regulated. And, you know, the government is getting more and more protected as we see, and putting conditionalities on what are the investments one can do. So one example which Vijay did mention was the most interesting one these days is China and Hong Kong. For example, there are now requirements for an approval if any investments are coming through those jurisdictions. So So if an investor has any such beneficial ownership or any such connection, that would be a big problem. Similarly, if you know, if an investor is coming into a sector which is regulated, which you know, there could be a requirement for an approval. On the and the next category is when an NR wants to transfer to a resident, that is possible. So we've seen one very interesting situation. One of the resident individual, one of the non-resident individual son decided to transfer his shares to his mother, as he was advised that, you know, there were certain compliances and certain other issues from a financial regulation perspective. So therefore, he did that transfer. A week later, that regulation, that issue got regularized, and we were advising on that regularization. That very week, 1 week later, he said, oh my God, this is now a big problem. Why don't I reverse this transaction? And we went back to RBI. Obviously, it was in multiples of the $550,000 limit. And RBI was very clear that, sorry, even though it's just a week and it's just a reversal, we are not keen to allow this. Similarly, an NRI and OCI could transfer shares between an NRI and OCI themselves. So that is another permitted transaction. Another question that we always keep getting is that how does one deal with an investment? So one example which we were discussing today, suppose I had been remitting money under the LRS scheme and I have acquired certain shares which are questionable today. There later on my status of residency changes and I want to transfer those shares. So what will it be? I mean, how would it really be looked at? Whether I'd be able to transfer or not be able to transfer, whether I'll require an approval if I was to transfer to another non-resident, to a resident. So here one will need to really examine the situation, because if your actual holding is not duly fully compliant, when you're transferring, you need to potentially need an approval, and seeking an approval could even open up the past issues, you know. So that is something that on a case-to-case basis, one needs to examine. The other question that we keep getting is the whether what happens if a person returns to India and has retained certain foreign assets abroad, whether that asset will be subject to any ODI compliances, other compliances, restrictions, etc. The answer to that, if they have retained that asset as a foreign asset, the answer to that should be no, because that is something that is basis your earnings abroad and which are retained abroad during a certain period of time. But one would certainly need to examine, you know, before arriving at a conclusion. So I think that brings me to the conclusion on the topics of, you know, NBFCs, FEMA, SEBI, and core investment companies. I think Bijal, I'd like to now invite Bijal to give us some insights on what is the future for the family offices.
Thank you, Puneet. So, we would
Bijal, your voice is not audible. Can you come a little closer?
Okay. Better?
I think it's a mic problem. If you could adjust your mic a little bit and then try. It's echoing.
Is this better?
Hello.
No.
Why don't you take it? Because I actually don't have a, I'm not wearing a mic. So I don't know how to do it.
Okay, so it's a mic, microphone port problem.
Maitri Ben, can we request her to log in again if that solves the problem?
Can I ask you to remove your virtual background and try again? Maybe it's a bandwidth issue because this is happening for the first time for you.
Or maybe, how about Vijal putting the video off for a few seconds and seeing?
Yes, we can try that as well.
Yeah, let's try that.
Okay, is this better?
No. I think it's a hardware problem. It's your port probably is wet. You know, some moisture gone into the microphone port.
Okay. That's too complicated for me. Mohan, why don't you do the conclusion if you don't mind?
Sure, I'll do. So I think, as the markets are getting more and more sophisticated and, the governance is becoming more and more streamlined, and we did discuss how the regulators are also getting more and more attentive to such situations. there will be an increase in the demand. We've seen a surge of super rich in India, and they would really want such flexibility and benefit for their family offices. And I think family offices will become instrumental in fueling the startup economy and the innovative businesses, because we've seen those examples in the case of Mr. Premji's office and Mr. Murthy's office. And in the days to come, this is going to be more and more sophisticated forms and more professionalized family offices, which will be clearly visible. As Bijal mentioned, that nowadays we do have some structures which, though are actually operating as family offices, they are not coming in the forefront and mentioning or categorizing themselves as such. But as a structure, this has been always ongoing as holding companies and holding structures for the assets of the family. Thank you very much, everyone. I think we'll be happy to now take up questions.
So Mohin, Bijal was kind enough when you were speaking. She has already answered 6 to 7 on the chat mode. If you can take 6-7 questions which are live.
Right.
If you want me, I can read. Or if you want, you can just go through the same.
I'll go through the questions. So I think the first question is on LLPs being able to hold investments. So I'll just read out the questions and then pick it up. So can an LLP hold investments? Wouldn't it be treated as activity of an NBFC? See, the question really is that the provisions which require registration of an NBFC under the RBI Act 45IA are only referring to a company today. Therefore, technically speaking, today, even if an LLP is holding investments, first of all, just to clarify, merely holding investments may not make it any company an NBFC also. But assuming it is holding investment which is crossing the 50-50 threshold and the principal business stress threshold, it will still not get hit by the requirement for registration until and unless the provisions are amended to bring even NBFCs under its purview. But I want to mention that that is clearly within the attention of the regulators, and they are, therefore you see such resistance when you try to register a new entity for investment of financial business in LLP. So that is something within their attention, and one would need to be careful to, you know, ensure that this is not a risk-free proposition, because you know effectively, just like I mentioned the example of a trust being set up abroad to do investment activity and you donating money under LRS, effectively you are trying to do something that is not directly allowed. One needs to, however, see whether this LLP was set up for investments or is set up for some other activity and is now slowly changing its principal business to investment holding. But I want to tell you that a lot of such investment holdings are existent. A lot of groups are having multiple LLPs and have actually converted company LLPs to get out of the NBFC requirement purview. The next question is, for a family office formed as a corporate entity, whether an RBI approval is required under FEMA? If yes, whether it is forthcoming? Now, RBI, as I mentioned, that if you set up a foreign family office abroad and such family office is set up for undertaking investment activity, an approval would be necessary under Regulation 7 of the ODI regulations, and you would need to fulfill the criteria. One of them was that you obtain a no objection certificate from the relevant regulator in India and in that jurisdiction. Second is that you show a track record, a profit track record of 3 years, and basis that you will be considered for an approval. Whether they are granting or not granting, I can tell you that just about last week we received 2 approvals for setting up such structures abroad. But the requirement is that the entity attempting to do this has to be itself a regulated entity in India. Because if you are not regulated in India as a financial entity, the approval is very unlikely. If you are regulated, then the chances of approval are high. But one would need to really see what is your profit track record? Another insight I want to share is that the government is looking very closely at overseas direct investments, and there could be potential amendments to make it more stricter, and this track record requirements may get more sort of intrusive and more difficult very soon. I think the next question is linked to it. In respect of ODI in financial service, if at the time of first few remittance company had profits for all 3 years, and at the time of subsequent remittance there is a small loss, whether approval of RBI is required? This is a very, very interesting question. You see, if you have set up and you've got the approval, there are two stages of getting approval. When you set up, you needed the approval for being able to set up that structure. If you now want to diversify into a step down entity engaged in similar business, you will need an approval. But for ongoing investments, one will need to see how it has impacted your net worth and your ability to invest at all. My personal view, if it has not impacted your net worth in a substantial manner and you still have bandwidth within that limit that's prescribed, you may be able to go and make an investment. The next question is, EB-5 program requires an investment of $500,000. The application for EB-5 can be in the name of an individual. However, it gives green card to the whole family. So can husband and wife both use their limits for the investments? I think for this purpose, you could use it. The ideal way would be through a joint account that you create overseas, so that when you're remitting into an account which is actually having a right so far as both the husband and wife are concerned, because effectively both the family members will get, the benefit of the green card akin to, and the requirement for joint ownership, I want to clarify, is only for capital assets. And this wouldn't constitute as a capital asset really. The next question is whether RBI is granting approval for round tripping. I think this is yet another very interesting question. So I'll give you a few examples of what we have seen. So there are three or four aspects that one needs to consider when you are approaching RBI for this approval. One is that what is your reason for this structure getting created? So we've seen one example where the foreign party was not agreeable to keep the holding structure in India because they were concerned of the legal system, IP protection, etc. We were able to convince RBI and we got an approval because though the actual business was in India, the holding of the business was from overseas. So RBI's first question when you approach them for these approvals is that why don't you instead? So it's if the Indian party is investing abroad in a company which effectively holds Indian investments, the question to the party is that why don't you instead invest in the Indian entity itself? Why are you investing into the overseas entity which is then after getting investments into India? To which there have been several different types of arguments. First is that this is an existing structure, so no new money is flowing into India. Second is that, as I mentioned, that for bona fide businesses, it is the other foreign party who wanted to have structure to be housed in a particular jurisdiction due to their comfort. To answer this in short, they gave an approval. We fortunately haven't seen a scenario where they have not given an approval to us in the last 6 or 7 applications we have made. But in reality, we've always been able to demonstrate a bona fide business requirement and structure. Another example I can share is a software company based out of the US had 18 subsidiaries in different jurisdictions in the world. One of them happened to be India. RBI was comfortable when the Indian family office was investing into this company abroad, because this was not a structure to round trip the funds, but it was a business need to be available on the ground to be able to service your clients from another jurisdiction. Now, another very good question is there any clarity on what financial service activity would comprise of? Here, there is very little clarity, and what we are therefore trying to do, even in the context of overseas companies, is that the thinking of regulator is 50-50. the thinking is principal business. So though strictly speaking, that may not be the apt, reading, but there is no clear definition which is bringing that and it is very, very broad. So therefore, any structure which would constitute financial service in our jurisdiction, for the moment, we should take it as financial service in the overseas jurisdiction as well. If family wants to externalize its business, is there any possible structure? What's the probability of RBI approving the structure? I think a little bit more clarity needed, but I'll tell you on the basis of my understanding. The issue is that if you want to externalize your business abroad, and if your business is a bona fide business, which is permitted, not being real estate, not being financial services, and not being investment into any products which are investing back into India, that would be workable. You may not necessarily need an approval from RBI unless you cross the 1 billion threshold. For all these automatic, and apart from financial services, just to clarify, you don't need an approval. You will be able to externalize. And that's really, so there is no question of RBI approval. What you need to do, however, is to ensure that you have a bona fide business overseas. The funds being sent are being first sent as equity, and only then you do any loan or infusion, because the requirement is that you first have equity and then give any guarantee or loan to that business. And you make the appropriate filings in a timely manner so that there is no delay at that end. And another thing to examine is that such business should not have an Indian connection. What I mean by Indian connection is that it should not have an existing Indian subsidiary or make any such Indian investments in future without having obtained a private an approval from the Reserve Bank of India.
Just here. Can I be heard?
Yes, we can hear you.
Is it better or is it as high?
It's actually still the same. I think there is some problem.
Go ahead, Bijal. Go ahead. We will hear what you want to speak. Go ahead.
Okay. No, I was just saying that, externalizing is essentially from a tax perspective. One and many situations people would essentially do is to create an entity outside of India, say under the LRS or through non-resident joint venture partners or relatives, and then they set up a subsidiary in India that would acquire the ongoing business. So in a way, you externalize the shareholder to make it non-resident.
Understood, Bijal. So I think
Moin, can you take the last one? The net profit of the LLP is computed at the year end. While finalizing the account, the same is credited to capital account. Can the same be considered as a current income and freely repatriable?
So I think this is again another question which becomes very relevant in the context of 1 million limit. Because the 1 million limit that's applicable to the NRO account, there are a lot of questions, because that limit does not apply to current income. There are questions around the fact that whether something that the LLP gives you as profit is akin to a dividend that you would have received from a company, and therefore you would treat it as current income and freely repatriable. I think one needs to see the color of that amount and the nature of the business and how this profit is generated. If it is really akin to profit distributed to the partners, that could be considered as current income. But I have seen another example where someone just settled all their assets to an LLP and then sells those assets. And then there is profit realized on that asset sale, and which gets distributed. Then effectively it is, whether it can be treated as dividend or whether it can be treated as a capital gain to that LLP, that's the question that one needs to see. But if it's a genuine business income of the LLP which is distributed, then it would constitute as current income.
Mohin, let me add you over here. RBI is taking a different view for the LLP. We fail to understand what the reason may be, but share of profit from the partnership firm is considered as a current income, but share of LLP, they are taking a different view, and we are facing with three authorized dealers who are saying you are not allowed as a current income, what is allowed is $1 million rupee.
I'll tell you, Rajeshbhai, the issue here, again, we've also seen that situation. We've seen one or two AD banks which have also allowed it. Because effectively, you are right, the resistance comes at the AD bank level. But I agree with you. The problem is that a lot of people have tried to exploit this, and maybe it has come to the attention of RBI. And therefore, RBI is treating LLPs differently. Also, because LLPs by itself have become controversial in the context of NBFCs, other businesses, etc. So, rightly so, they may have given some internal guidelines to some ADs, and they must have burnt their hands, you know, trying to send out these monies. Because it's, I think, to some extent also driven by your declaration that what you are categorizing and telling the AD. We've also seen another example where something that out and out looked like a something that was not dividend or payout. It was just a structure, and the AD was comfortable basis some opinion from some particular advisor. So that is also, maybe that is why RBI is getting more alert on this issue. But very interesting point. Thank you, Rajiv.
We have 6 minutes to close the session and 2 questions left. Mohit, would you like to take those two sessions?
Yes, I'll be very happy to take. I'll try to quickly take up the question. So will settlement of property in a trust by a resident which has beneficiaries as non-resident, whether this structure would need any approval from an FDI perspective? I don't have complete, again, clarity on this. Is this a trust that is a trust overseas, or a trust which is set up in India? Assuming this is a trust set up overseas with non-resident beneficiaries, the issue really is going to be, what is the property that you're settling? Because transfer of property also is linked to the residency status, etc. So this could be a problem, and there could be a requirement for an approval. We've seen some situation where in the context of an HUF, an approval has been sought from RBI because of non-residents being involved. So this will need to be thought a little more. The next one is...
Mohit, let me add over here. This question is, since it is an FDI perspective, what we need to answer the question person who has raised, is this a Indian trust with a non-resident beneficiaries?
Okay.
So a settlement of a property in a trust by a resident which has a beneficiaries as a non-resident, which is an Indian trust.
Okay. So then here again, I think because there's an FDI perspective here, just bringing in non-resident beneficiaries, again, I would need to examine what kind of properties, etc. are involved, because bringing in these non-resident beneficiaries to get interest and rights into certain Indian assets without having spent any amounts, etc. There could be a requirement for an approval. The stage would be relevant because distribution may not happen till the end. At what stage there would actual actioning or actual remittance of funds or grant of rights is the stage where you may need to obtain an approval then. The next question is, funds remitted under LRS as share capital and business was carried out from that company. And after 15 years, this overseas company wants to invest in Indian business. Is it permissible? I think this question, again, as I mentioned, that if it's prior to 2013, there have been many such cases where people have created a corpus overseas and they want to now bring that money back. But there is a problem because RBI is looking at all such investments they're actually looking at all such investments in a way that they were not permitted. And only in 2013, they say we permitted you to invest in share capital of a company abroad. So going for an approval will be necessary because it's also a round tripping, but the grant of approval will really be, questionable. We will not really have complete clarity on whether they will at all consider this or not consider this. Sorry, Rajeshbhai, what is the next question? This is the, I think that question has gone away or?
No, it's the next, there.
LRS one I can't see now. Anyways, I think the next one is.
1 minute, do you want to see LRS
one? I think we've answered that. That's fine.
Yes.
Indian company having a WS overseas wants to buy our office premises, value of which is almost less than 5% of the net worth of the Indian company. Is it possible to acquire the same under ODI or RBI approval is required? See, if an Indian company has a wholly owned subsidiary abroad, such a company can buy overseas properties as they like for the purposes of their business with the monies that they have retained in that overseas company abroad. The limit of net worth will not be applicable. That is applicable if you want to buy directly from your Indian company and want to pay out from your Indian company. But because you have a wholly owned subsidiary, so long as your investment is within the limits, you will not require an RBI approval. Only other thing is that such premises are bought for the purposes of your business and not for any other purpose. The next question is, when a person sets up an Indian trust for his relatives in, just a second, I can't, in India and settles Indian, can the shares in the trust be distributed to resident beneficiaries? Again, when an NR person is setting up, so here again, the question is specific to whether an NR person by itself can set up a trust, whether they are using their Indian assets that they are retaining in India. But that being said, NRs are allowed to gift shares to their residents. NRs are allowed to give shares to the residents. And I'm looking at the assets. These assets are also Indian assets, right?
Yes.
Again, we'll have to see what the relevant Indian assets are. Because here it is more flexible, because effectively it is a non-resident who is giving benefits to an Indian resident. But we will need to see what the real assets are. And we need to see how we will, you know, how this is being structured and what assets the NR is using for, you know, sort of creating that trust, and whether they have any connection to India as an NRI or otherwise to be able to have certain Indian assets available.
Thanks, Moin. It was great.
My pleasure. I think right on time.
Time we have been able to complete.